Hi, good morning, guys. So, as per the syllabus in Unit 3 in Carbohydrate Metabolism, today we are going to see about the last subunit other than important pathways. So, in a carbohydrate metabolism, we have already seen different cycles and important pathways like glycolysis, TCA cycle, HMP stunt, and gluconeogenesis, and glycogenesis, glycogenolysis. All those things we have discussed in the earlier class. And apart from that, what are the regulators, hormonal regulators, and internal ions? How it's going to affect, how is going to regulate this kind of pathway? Those things also we have seen in last class. So in today I am going to explain about the apart from this pathway some carbohydrates apart from this pathway carbohydrates may enter in some other may pathways also. So those pathway I have mentioned in other pathways. So apart from glucose, carbohydrate molecules, galactose, fructose, mannose. So these are the things, how is going to metabolize, how it's going to convert it into the other product, how it's going to produce energy. So those are the things is comes under this chapter. Okay, so in other pathway it's majorly divided into five things. First one is uronic acid pathway, second one is metabolism of galactose and fructose and synthesis of amino sugar and glyoxylate cycle. So the each individual cycle is having own unique characteristics. So unique substrate it may convert into the different end product. So name wise it say the metabolism of galactose and fructose, its name itself is indicate it's going to metabolic process of galactose and fructose. So uronic acid pathway, it's a pathway, it's responsible for production of glucuronic acid. The acid is having a important role in metabolism process. When you can come across second year of pharmacology, that time you know about the various phases of metabolism, phase 1 and phase 2. In phase 2, the conjugation metabolism process, the one of the major important thing is glucuronic acid conjugation. So it's one of the important substance for metabolism of various drugs. So how it's going to synthesize those glucuronic acid? It comes to this point. Uronic acid pathway is responsible for production of glucuronic acid synthesis. Then and apart from that, in our body we having glycoproteins, glycosamines and glycolipids. So those are the things is having unique role. So those are the things is called as amino sugars. So how it's going to synthesize? From the sugar molecule, how is going to synthesize amino sugars? Then finally, glyoxylate cycle. So what is glyoxylate cycle? How it's going to different? So how the fat is converted into the glucose? All those things we have seen in this class. So first I can go for the uronic acid pathway. You can see here, it's alternative oxidative pathway. It is alternative oxidative pathway for glucose and also it's called as glucuronic acid pathway because the end product is going to form a glucuronic acid. So majorly it's divided into the four steps. Okay, so the entire pathway is divided into four steps. So in these steps you have seen the dietary xylose. Actually what's happened exactly, the synthesis of glucuronic acids and pentose and vitamin and ascorbic acid, these are the product in this pathway. So at the end of this pathway it's going to produce glucuronic acid, pentose and some vitamins like ascorbic acids. So if it is a dietary xylose, if you take the xylose in your food habits, means the dietary xylose it's directly is entered to the uronic acid pathway which can participate this metabolism. So this metabolic process has been divided into four individual steps. So first one is going to formation of UDP glucuronate. The first step is going to synthesize UDP glucuronate. The second one is conversion of UDP glucuronate into L-glucuronate. L-glucuronate. First one is UDP glucuronate. Then second one is from UDP glucuronate to L-glucuronate. The third one is from this steps is going to divide into two subdivisions. One is the same L-glucuronate is enter into the one pathway. It's going to synthesis of ascorbic acid. You can see here the L-glucuronate is going to split into two steps. In one pathway, it's going to produce the ascorbic acid. In other way, it's going to produce the xylose biphosphate. So this is entire pathway. It has been divided into four steps. So one, first one is UDP glucuronate. Second one is formation of L-glucuronate. The third one is synthesis of ascorbic acid. The fourth one is oxidation of L-glucuronate. It's converted into the xylose biphosphate. So next you can see here the stepwise reaction. In first step, formation of UDP glucuronate. So in this reaction, you can just see this picture. The starting material is same, glucose 6-phosphate. So it's converted into the glucose 1-phosphate with the help of phosphoglucomutase enzyme. That enzyme is responsible for conversion of glucose 6-phosphate to glucose 1-phosphate. So up to here, you can see the synthesis somewhat similar. Can you imagine where it is? Can you guess it where it is happened this exact this pathway? This pathway is same close resemble to the glycogenesis pathway, because up to here the pathway is similar in glycogenesis pathway, because the glucose 6-phosphate converted into the glucose 6-phosphate, the 1-phosphate, then it's converted into the UDP glucose. So in glycogenesis, from the UDP glucose is going to attach with the primer. That means glycogen primer, otherwise glycogenin. So it's going to attach with the primer, it's going to elongation of chain, it's become a glycogen. But in scenario, in uronic acid pathway, the UDP glucose, it's converted into the UDP glucuronate. That's a difference. With the help of UDP glucose dehydrogenase enzyme, that enzyme is responsible for conversion of UDP glucose into UDP glucuronate. So up to here, the steps are over. So the UDP glucuronate is also required for synthesis of glycosaminoglycans and proteoglycans. So this is the reaction. First step is over. From the glucose 6-phosphate, convert to 1-phosphate, then it's UDP glucose, then glucuronate, UDP glucuronate. So the second reaction, from the conversion of UDP glucuronate into L-glucuronate. So the same thing, once the UDP glucuronate is going to convert into D-glucuronate. So what's happened exactly? It's a hydrolytic reaction with the addition of water molecule. It's going to remove the UDP with the help of glucuronidase enzymes. So it's convert the substrate into product. The UDP glucuronate is converted into the D-glucuronate. This D-glucuronate is going to reduced into L-glucuronate by NADPH dependent reactions. So you can see here same things. D-glucuronate is converted into the L-glucuronate. So from here, from this step, it's going to split it into two reactions. One side is going to synthesize the ascorbic acids, and another side is going to xylose 5-phosphate. So we can go for the third reaction, is going to synthesize the ascorbic acid in some animal species. The L-glucuronate, it's a precursor for synthesis of ascorbic acid. It's going to oxidize. Then it's converted into the 2-keto L-glucuronate. Then it's further converted into the L-ascorbic acid. So this enzyme, the L-glulactone oxidase enzyme, it's responsible for the ascorbic acid synthesis. Unfortunately, this enzyme is not available in some species. Example, humans and primates like guinea pigs. So we don't have a that enzyme L-glucuronate oxidase, glucuronolactone acid oxidase enzyme. So because of that, we can't able to synthesize the vitamin C. So for those reasons, once you keep the guinea pig in our animal house, means we must give the vitamin C supplement, because it can't able to synthesize the vitamin C. So for regular metabolic process, it's need a vitamin C. So we can give the vitamin C supplement through its diet. So the fourth one, as I said earlier, the same L-glucuronate is converted into the ascorbic acid with the help of L-glucuronolactone oxidase enzyme. In parallel side, the same L-glucuronate is converted into the xylose 5-phosphate. Actually, the L-glucuronate is oxidized, it's converted into the ketoglutarate. Then it's going to decarboxylate, it's converted into the L-glucose. It's going to L-glucose. First is converted into the 3-keto L-glutarate, then it's going to decarboxylated, then it's converted into the L-xylose. The L-xylose, it's converted into the D-xylose. To intermediate product is going to form a xylitol. So these are the intermediate product. At the end, it's going to reduce NADPH, is going to donate the hydrogen, then it's get back the hydrogen, it's going to oxidize and reduce. Whatever it is, simply the L-xylose, it's converted into the D-xylose with the help of xylitol dehydrogenase enzyme. So at last, the D-xylose, it's converted into the xylose 5-phosphate. Once if it is formation of xylose 5-phosphate means it's a substrate for the HMP pathway. So it's entered into the HMP pathway. So that's all. Uranic acid pathway is going to 4 steps. The 4 steps has been completed. The first one is going to form a from the glucose 6-phosphate. First we can go for the from the glucose 6-phosphate, it's converted into the UDP glucuronate. Up to UDP glucose is going to form. It's same like a glycogenesis pathway. Then after that, with the help of UDP glucose dehydrogenase enzyme, it's converted into the UDP glucuronate. Then second step, the UDP glucuronate, it's converted into the L-glucuronate. So it's converted into the glucuronase enzyme, it's converted into the D-glucuronate. Then further it's reduced, it's converted into the L-glucuronate. So L-glucuronate, it's responsible for production of 2 things, xylose 5-phosphate and ascorbic acid. So here L-glucuronate, it's oxidized with the help of L-glucuronolactone oxidase enzyme, it's converted into the ascorbic acid. So in parallel side, the same L-glucuronate, it's converted into the xylose 5-phosphate with the help of xylitol dehydrogenase enzyme. So that is the reactions. So some kind of drugs, effect of drugs on uranic acid pathway, some kind of drugs like barbiturates and chlorobutanol, these are the drugs is going to increase the uranic acid pathway because it's achieve more synthesis of glucuronate from the glucose. That means it's going to promote the metabolic process because glucuronate is one of the major metabolic process, glucuronyl conjugation. So once it's going to increase the production of glucuronate means it's going to increase the metabolic rate mediated those enzyme. So certain drugs like aminopyrine or antipyrine drugs, it enhances synthesis of ascorbic acid. So the product is starting material is same. Either from the L-glucuronate, it's converted into the xylose 5-phosphate or ascorbic acid. So one is going to increase the glucuronate production. Some kind of drugs is going to promote the ascorbic acid production. So in some of the cases, in genetic disorders, some rare genetic disorders, it's related to deficiency of NADP-dependent xylitol dehydrogenase. So we know that what is the importance of those enzymes. The xylitol dehydrogenase is responsible for the conversion of xylose 5-phosphate from L-xylitol to D-xylitol. For those conversion, that enzyme is having vital role. So because of defect this enzyme, the L-xylose can't be converted into xylitol. The first cell step itself is can't able to done. So once xylitol form means it's further converted into the D-xylose, then finally it's converted into the xylose 5-phosphate. So lack of this enzyme, though it's never going to convert into xylitol. So what's happened? The L-xylose concentration has become more, so it's going to eliminate through urine. Apart from that, it's called as pentosuria. So apart from that, it doesn't have any kind of suffer otherwise ill effects to the patients. Just simply xylose concentration is going to increase. Once increase means it's going to eliminate from urine. So next we can go for the metabolism of galactose. So next we can go for the metabolism of galactose. So the galactose is one of the best example for product of lactose. So we know that lactose is a disaccharide. So it's a combination of one glucose molecule and one galactose molecule. So the lactose disaccharide, it's metabolized by lactase enzyme. That enzyme is present on the intestinal mucosal cell, so it's going to hydrolyze the lactose. It's converted into galactose and glucose. So we know that the once glucose is going to form, it's going to enter into the various metabolic pathway. But what about galactose? That's important. So the galactose, it's also produced within the cell. So the galactose also is going to produce from within this cell, because during lysosomal degradation, example the glycoproteins and glycolipids, once the glycoproteins or glycolipids are under the lysosomal degradation, means that's also is going to produce the galactose. Normally we know that the galactose is a material for lactose product. Whenever we had the milk products, it's having a lactose. Apart from that, the glycoproteins and glycolipids, once it's undergo the degradation, means from that reactions also, from that catabolic reaction also, is going to produce galactose. So as in case for fructose, galactose into the cell, it's not dependent in the insulin. That means insulin independent manner, the fructose and galactose are is going to absorb. But in glucose, the glucose absorption, it's may depend upon the insulin dependent and insulin non dependent. So but here fructose and galactose, if we want to enter into the cell, the insulin, it's not mandatory. Without insulin involvement, fructose and galactose are is going to enter into the cell. So we can see here the reaction. So first, the galactose molecule with presence of aldose reductase enzymes, if the galactose molecule is available, means with presence of aldose reductase enzyme, it's converted into the galactitol. So in this reactions, the NADPH is going to give the hydrogen ions, so the galactose is going to reduce into galactitol. The next step, the same, the galactose, with the help of galactokinase enzyme, the galactose is converted into the galactose 1 phosphate. Actually what's happened is going to phosphorylate. So galactose is undergoing the phosphorylate with the help of galactokinase enzyme. So the phosphorylation is going to helpful by the donation of phosphate group by ATP. So ATP is going to donate the 1 phosphate group, then it's down related into ADP. So the phosphorylation is going to happen with galactose, it's converted into galactose 1 phosphate. Then next, this galactose 1 phosphate, it's converted into the glucose 1 phosphate. So simply you can see here, the galactose molecule, it's going to switch into glucose. How is it going to happen? What is the possible way? Means the glucose molecule is going to donated by UDP glucose. You can see here the galactose 1 phosphate is there, the parallelly the UDP glucose also available. So with the help of the uridyl transferase enzyme, particularly the glucose 1 phosphate uridyl transferase enzyme, what's happened this enzyme? This enzyme is going to switch over the major moiety. The glucose molecule is going to donate, is going to gain the galactose. It's going to simply transfer the major groups. So the glucose group is going to donate and is going to gain the galactose. So the result is going to produce the glucose 1 phosphate. The UDP is going to gain the UDP galactose. So this UDP galactose, it's converted into the, once again it's converted into the UDP glucose with the help of UDP hexoepimerase enzyme. So the enzyme is responsible for continuous conversion of UDP galactose into UDP glucose. We know that once the UDP glucose is going to form, means with the presence of primer, glycogen primer, is going to start the glycogen synthesis. So that's its one pathway. So in the next, now the glucose 1 phosphate is formed, then what about the next? So once the glucose phosphate 1 phosphate is formed, means it's converted into the glucose 6 phosphate with the help of phosphoglucomutase enzyme. We know that these are the things we have seen in gluconeogenesis process. It's a reversible reactions. So the glucose 1 phosphate is converted into the glucose 6 phosphate with the help of phosphoglucomutase enzyme. So finally, the glucose 6 phosphate is formed, means automatically is entered into the either glycolysis pathway for energy productions, otherwise it's become converted into the glucose for energy resource. So that's a reaction. The same time, in parallelly, the UDP galactose, as I said earlier, the UDP galactose is converted into the UDP glucose for the glycogen synthesis. Otherwise, the same UDP galactose, with the presence of lactate synthase enzyme, it's converted into lactose in mammary gland. So it's going to produce the lactose. Then parallelly, the same UDP galactose, it's responsible for production of glycosaminoglycans and glycolipids and glycoproteins. So this is the entire reaction. So once galactose is available, means with the presence of aldose reductase, it's converted into the galactitalol. It's presence of, that means it's going to reduce, it's going to donated by the NADP, it's going to donate the hydrogen ions. Then it's converted into the UDP, sorry. Next is converted into the galactose 1 phosphate with the galactokinase. Then it's converted into the glucose 6 phosphate with the donate the glucose molecule. The galactose is gained by the UDP. So it's converted into the UDP galactose. Then it's UDP galactose, it's once again it's converted into the UDP glucose, then glycogen going to formation. Otherwise, the glucose parallelly, the glucose 1 phosphate is converted into the glucose 6 phosphate, then it's entered into the glycolysis cycle, otherwise it's converted into the glucose. The UDP galactose with presence of lactose synthase enzyme, it's going to synthesize the lactose. Otherwise, parallelly it's going to responsible for synthesis of glycosaminoglycans and glycolipids and glycoproteins. That is metabolism of galactose. So the same pathway I have explained in text manner. You no need to bother about this text and all. So if you have any case, the metabolic process is going to affect because of lack of any sufficient enzyme, essential enzyme, it may produce the accumulation of galactose. So it's called as galactosemia. The galactosemia, it's nothing but it's a rare occasion incidence. It may occur for the very rare, 1 in 30,000 ratio. So what is the thing is means is going to due to the deficiency of the enzyme galactose 1 phosphate uridyl transferase. So we know that the galactose uridyl transferase, 1 phosphate uridyl transferase, responsible for the transferring of galactose molecule and glucose molecule. So once this enzyme is not available, means the galactose is 1 phosphate, it's never converted into glucose 1 phosphate. So it's lead to accumulation of galactose. The high galactose levels in circulation, it's called as galactosemia. If it is eliminated through urine, means it's called as galactosuria. So another one problem is there. So during the accumulation of galactose, it may reduced, it's converted into the galactitol with the help of aldose reductase enzyme. So this enzymes is available in mostly present on not available in liver, but it's mostly present on the lens, nervous tissue and seminal vesicles. So this galactose is converted into the galactitol in those places. So what's the thing is there, once accumulation of galactose, it's converted 1 phosphate, it's converted into the galactitol in various places. So it's lead to impairment of those function, because the high level of galactose 1 phosphate, it's result to depletion of inorganic phosphates, because we know that the inorganic phosphate is essential for the phosphorylation of various reactions. So if it is more available of galactose 1 phosphate, means is going to deplete the inorganic phosphate. So sequencing phosphates is going to reduce, so it's going to affect the metabolic function. So apart from that, the galactitol, we know that it's conversion in lens and nervous tissue. So it's going to more amount of conversion of convert into galactitol, means it's lead to accumulation, it's lead to development of cataract. So the treatment, just deprive the galactose or lactose product. So that's all. The next we can go for the metabolism of fructose. So once the fructose is enter into the metabolic pathway, means with the presence of hexokinase enzyme, it's a less affinity enzyme. So it's partially, it's the fructose is kind converted into the fructose 6-phosphate. That means its phosphorylation is going to happen. It's converted into the fructose 6-phosphate. Mostly the fructose is converted into the sorbitol. Otherwise, from the sorbitol, it's converted into the fructose also, because it's an interconvertible reaction. So both the fructose to sorbitol conversion also possible, sorbitol to fructose conversion also possible. So the fructose is converted into two direction. One is going to phosphorylate it. It's converted into fructose 6-phosphate. Otherwise, it's going to sorbitol. So the next step is, from the fructose 6-phosphate, with the help of phosphohexoisomerase enzyme, it's converted into the glucose 6-phosphate. So from the glucose 6-phosphate, it may enter into the glycogen synthesis process. That is one way. At the same time, the glucose 6-phosphate, it's down-related. It's going to reduce the 1-phosphorylated group with the help of glucose 6-phosphatase enzyme. That enzyme is going to dephosphorylate the phosphate group. So the glucose 6-phosphate, it's converted into the glucose. So once the glucose is available, with the help of same aldose reductase enzyme, that enzyme is responsible for production of glucose into sorbitol. In the same reaction we have seen in galactose. Galactose is converted into the galcitol. The same manner the glucose is converted into the sorbitol also. So when sorbitol is going to form, means it's based upon availability of the enzyme. Once the sorbitol dehydrogenase is available, means the sorbitol is converted into the fructose. Otherwise, it's going to accumulate in the cell itself. If it is lens or nerve, means from that place itself is going to accumulate. It's lead to produce some complications. So the next one is, the fructose, it may enter into the sorbitol. Otherwise, it's converted into the phosphorylated. It's converted into the 6-phosphate. Then it's converted into the glucose 6-phosphate. It may enter into the glucose. The cycle is going to two direction. The same manner, the fructose, with the help of fructokinase enzyme, it's converted into the fructose 1-phosphate. So here, with the availability of aldolase B enzyme, aldolase B enzyme, it's going to split into glyceraldehyde, then it's further converted into the glycerol. The fructose, it's responsible for production of glycerol. Once the glycerol is going to form, means it's lead to the atherosclerosis, it's going to lipid generation. So it's lead to the atherosclerosis. So it's a very high lipogenic nature. Fructose is, if a high dose of fructose we have taken, it's produced lipogenic in nature. So you can see here, same thing, once the glyceraldehyde is going to form from the fructose 1,6-phosphate, the parallel is going to form a DHAP, dihydroacetone phosphate. The same manner, with presence of triokinase enzyme, the glyceraldehyde is converted into the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. So from the glyceraldehyde is directly entered into the DHAP, dihydroacetone phosphate, then it's converted into the, with the help of triokinase enzyme, it's converted into the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. So these are both the reaction also, it's an interconvertible reactions with the help of triose phosphate isomerase enzyme. That enzyme is responsible for the interconversion reaction. So here you can see there the fructose 1,6-phosphate with the help of aldolase A enzyme, the same manner. Fructose 1,6-phosphate is going to split the reaction. The same manner, fructose 1,6-phosphate with presence of aldose A enzyme is going to carry out the same reactions. So as I said earlier, the fructose 1 is responsible for production of glycerol. Okay. So the glycerol is converted into the glycerol 3-phosphate. Then it's further is converted into the formation of triacyl glycerol and phospholipids. It's going to produce lipogenesis nature. So this reaction is catalyzed by glycerol kinase enzyme. So the glycerol, it's converted into the glycerol 3-phosphate with the help of glycerol kinase enzyme. So next, the glycerol 3-phosphate, it's once again dehydrogenase, it's converted into the DHAP, the same product. So the DHAP is going to, once again, is going to participate with the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, then it's entered into the glycolysis cycle. So this is overall fructose metabolism cycle. So from the starting itself, I can say, so once the fructose it first is going to two direction. One is convert to sorbitol, otherwise is going to convert into the fructose 6 phosphate. Then it's converted into the glucose 6 phosphate. From that it's converted into the glucose. That glucose is converted into sorbitol. Sorbitol is once again is converted into the fructose. It's an interconversible reaction. Otherwise, this 1, 2, 3 reaction is over. The same manner the fructose is converted into the fructose 1 phosphate, then it's splitted into the glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate and dihydroacetone phosphate. Once the glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate is further converted into the glycerol, then byproduct dihydroacetone and glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate, the both the things is going to enter into the glycolysis cycle. So in parallel, the glyceraldehyde is converted into the glycerol. That glycerol is going to it's converted into the glycerol 3 phosphate with the help of glycerol kinase enzyme. It's going to production of lipids, triacylglycerol and phospholipids. So once again, it's converted into the DHAP. The DHAP is going to participate in glycolysis cycle. This is overall fructose metabolism. So metabolism of fructose, that's the same things I have written in text. Yeah. The next one is sorbitol pathway. As I said earlier, the glucose is converted into the sorbitol with the help of aldose reductase enzyme. So in uncontrolled diabetes conditions, what's happened? The excess amount of glucose, high amount of glucose, it's converted into the sorbitol. So the sorbitol is going to accumulate in the cell itself. If it is because the aldose reductase is available in lens and nervous tissue. So mostly that place, it's going to convert into the sorbitol. But this once it's going to convert means it may enter into the next pathway. The next pathway means the sorbitol dehydrogenase enzyme. It's responsible for carry out the things. That means it's further reduced into fructose. If it is fructose is convert means it's enter into the various cycle. So this exactly the sorbitol dehydrogenase is present in the seminal vesicles and spleen and ovaries. So fructose is one of the preferred carbohydrate for energy need for the sperm cells. So in sperm cell, in seminal vesicles, it's going to gain the fructose molecule with the help of this pathway. Glucose is converted into the sorbitol, sorbitol converted into the fructose. That fructose is utilized for the energy utilization for the sperm cells. But what the problem in diabetic conditions, in the excess amount of glucose is there, so it's converted into the more amount of sorbitol. It can't able to convert, it's not convert into fructose. Because the fructose dehydrogenase enzyme is the sorbitol dehydrogenase enzyme is responsible for conversion. So the sorbitol can't able to convert into fructose. So what's happened? It's going to accumulation of sorbitol. So the place itself, if it is lens, otherwise neuron, otherwise kidney, that place itself, the sorbitol is going to accumulate. It's lead to complication. If it is lens means it's produced cataract. If it is neuron, nerve means it's produced neuropathic inflammations. Nephron means it's produced nephropathy. So that's a complications. Most of the diabetic complications, it's made due to the sorbitol pathway. That's a thing. So if it is fructose metabolism due to lack of those enzyme, fructokinase or aldose enzyme deficiency, it may produce some defects. So for those cases, you have just a treatment, you just deprivate the fructose product from the diet. That is a and apart from that, high fructose consumption is risk. Yes, it's a risk because the fructose metabolic pathway itself, we know that it is more amount it's enter into the glycerol synthesis. So more amount of lipids is going to synthesis, it may produce the lipogenesis process. So it's lead to atherosclerosis. So it's very high risk for the patients. So the next one is other pathways, amino sugar synthesis. So here you can see that the glucose is the starting material. It's converted into the glucose 6 phosphate. Then it's converted into the fructose 6 phosphate. Then with the help of amino transferase enzyme, it's converted into the glucosamine 6 phosphate. So the glucosamine is going to participate in the reaction. With the presence of aminotransferase enzyme and glucosamine, the fructose 6 phosphate is going to convert into the glucosamine 6 phosphate. So in this reaction, the glutamine is converted into the glutamate. Glucose 6 phosphate, fructose 6 phosphate, then glucosamine is going to enter into the reaction. So it's converted into the glucosamine 6 phosphate. So the next one is the glucosamine is converted into the glucosamine, downregulated into the glucosamine 1 phosphate. Then UDP is going to donate, so it's converted into the UDP glucosamine. Then finally, it's converted into the glucosamine glycans. So that is one reaction. Fructose, glucosamine is going to participate. It's going to convert into the glucosamine 6 phosphate. Then glucosamine 1 phosphate. UDP is conversion. UDP glucosamine. Then finally, glucosamino glycans is going to form. The parallelly, from the glucosamine 6 phosphate, the acetyl CoA is going to involve the reaction, the second reaction. One is this pathway, the second one is acetyl CoA is going to catalyze, acetyl CoA is going to involve the reactions. With the presence of acetyl CoA, it's going to convert the N-acetyl glucosamine 6 phosphate. So acetyl CoA is going to attach with the glucosamine 6 phosphate. Acetylation is going to happen. So it's converted into the N-acetyl glucosamine 6 phosphate. Then epimerase enzyme is responsible for conversion of N-acetyl monosamine 6 phosphate. The glucosamine is converted into the monosamine. Then finally, with presence of phosphoenol pyruvate, it's converted into the N-acetyl neuroaminic acid 9 phosphate. So that's responsible for production of glycoproteins and gangliosides and sialic acids. So one pathway is going to produce the glucosamine glycans. The second one is glycoproteins. So the next one, the same manner from the intermediate product, from the N-acetyl glucosamines, it's converted into the N, it's downregulated. Once again, the dephosphorylation is going to, phosphorylation is going to happen, interconversion. So the N-acetyl glucosamine, it's converted into the N-acetyl glucosamine 1 phosphate. Then same manner, here also the UDP is going to participate. So its UDP is going to attach. So it's converted into the UDP N-acetyl glucosamine. That is a responsible enzyme here. The epimerase enzyme responsible for production of the same glycoproteins and glycosaminoglycans. So this is the reaction. So the glucose is finally it's converted into the amino sugar, glycosaminoglycans, otherwise glycoproteins and glycosolipids also. So this is the reactions. Yeah. So the next fifth one, last one is cycle is glyoxylate cycle. So normally in our humans, the lipids is can't able to convert into the glucose. But in plants, the scenario is going to be different. So the plant seed, it's mostly it's present on the steroids. So that steroids during germination process, it's converted into the glucose for the germination process. So the lipids is converted into the glucose. This things is happen in plants, but it's not possible to happen in humans. So I can explain in next slide. So you can see there the cycle, the same things, acetyl CoA, the same citric acid cycle. It's going to like a same bypass of citric acid cycle. So from the fatty acid oxidation, it's converted into the acetyl CoA. So this is a starting material for citric acid cycle. So oxaloacetate and acetyl CoA, it's going to convert into the citrate. So the citrate is further converted into the isocitrate with the help of acetonitrase enzyme. So after that, isocitrate, it's enter into the same pathway. It's converted into the succinyl CoA, succinate, fumarate, malate. It's once again, it's converted into the oxaloacetate. The cycle is going to continue. But how is going to bypass means from the isocitrate, it's converted into the glyoxylate. So it's divided into two products, succinate and glyoxylate. So the succinate means it's once again it's enter into the same cycle, it's going to enter into the glucose production. But the glyoxylate means from the isocitrate it's going to form a glyoxylate means it's convert glyoxylate, it's further converted into the malate. That means the acetyl CoA is going to remove with the help of malate synthase enzyme. So isocitrate, with the help of isocitrate lyase enzyme, it's converted into the glyoxylate. The glyoxylate, the acetyl group is going to remove. Then with the presence of malate synthase enzyme, it's converted into the malate. So once the malate is in the available means, it's enter into the same glycolysis, same TCA cycle is going to happen. So as I said earlier, The plants and many organisms, it's equipped with this metabolic pathway, glycosyl cycle, but it has never happened in the humans. The cycle is responsible for the converting fat into carbohydrates. Because we know that the fatty acid is starting material, we know that from the glucose it's enter into the convert into the acetyl CoA. The same manner the fatty acid is oxidized, means it's reduced into acetyl CoA. So fatty acid is converted into acetyl CoA, that acetyl CoA is enter into the TCA cycle. That TCA cycle is going to production of isocitrate, this intermediate product. From the isocitrate, it's converted into the glucose. So from that manner, otherwise the it's going to form a glyoxylate. The glyoxylate is converted into the malate. Same reaction. So from this reaction is going to produce the glucose molecule. So that process is very essential for the germination of seeds, because in seeds is having a steroids, fat material. During germination process, the fat is converted into the glucose. That thing is going to happen. So the location of cycle in plants is going to happen on the glyoxosomes. So it's a specialized cellular organs for to convert these reactions. So that's all apart from that. The same things I have written in text manner. So the glucose tolerance test, as I said earlier, it's to determine whether the person is tolerated with glucose or not, to determine the case. Whether the from that test we can able to say the person is pre-diabetic condition, otherwise diabetic condition, otherwise severe diabetic condition, we can say that. So in that test, what the thing is there? So the person is not restricted to take carbohydrate, but only one condition, the before doing the test, the last night the person must be fasting. That around 8 to 12 hours fasting is mandatory. So you can allow the consumption of water, but no, not allowed to any juices. Otherwise, food during the test, you can give the measured dose of glucose, around 75 gram of glucose. You can zero time, you can remove the blood, then you check the blood glucose level. Then after that, you can give the measured amount of glucose. The person is to take the solution at a single stretch. Otherwise, within time frame, 5 minutes time, the person take the measured glucose amount. After that, every interval, every half an hour interval, we have to withdraw the blood, measure the blood glucose. So based upon the blood glucose level, we can say whether the person is impaired with glucose or not. So normally the fasting glucose level is 100 mg per deciliter. So it may up to 120 also. In fasting glucose level, up to 100 to 125 means the person is having mild impair with fasting glucose. So the fasting glucose is more than 126. So means it's a condition is called as diabetics. So it's zero time interval. In zero time, you have to take the blood. From the blood, you can measure the blood glucose level. If it is comes into the three scenario means less than 100 means no problem. 125 means up to 0 to 125 means impairment. More than 125 means it's a diabetic condition. So during the test, glucose tolerance test, after 2 hours, the blood glucose is may exceed more than 140 means it is hyperglycemic condition. Because the person is we are administered the glucose, definitely the glucose is going to shoot up. So it's lead to up to 140 means it's called as hyperglycemic condition. But in case the blood glucose level is going to beyond 140, up to 200 means we can say that the person is impaired with glucose tolerance. If it is more than 200 means we can confirm that the person is diabetic. So from this test we can able to determine the person is having glucose tolerance, otherwise pre-diabetic, otherwise diabetic conditions. So it's one of the real tests we can prove that the person is really having diabetes or not. Instead of taking a single blood test, we can't say the person is diabetic. You must do with this glucose tolerance test, then only you can confirm the person is diabetic. So the galactose tolerance test, it's a same method. You can give the galactose in measured volume. You have to determine with you can administer through oral method, otherwise intravenous method. If it is oral method, if it is elimination more than 3 grams, you can give the measured volume. If it is the elimination is more than 3 gram of galactose in urine within 5 hours means it's indicate the liver damage. it's indicate it doesn't having a sufficient enzymes. Galactose metabolic enzyme is not available, so galactose is going to eliminate. So in oral method, if it is you are administered the galactose in the intravenous method, means all galactose should have been eliminated from the blood within 45 minutes. If you are administered IV, you just check the blood galactose level. Within 45 minutes, the entire galactose, it must be converted into the other product. Otherwise, we can know that it's having a problem. Due to the lack of galactose metabolic enzyme, galactose is not converted into the product. So we can determine the cases. So that's all. So here itself, I can wind up this class. So in next class, I can give the overall summarization for entire carbohydrate metabolism. Thank you.